Jonathan Berman, author of Success in Africa. It's a great pleasure to be sitting here with you today at the Serena in Nairobi.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to see you, Ali Khan.
No, I mean, you know, we've been sort of communicating in all kinds of ways with these new modern Twitter, and I really appreciated you sending me your book.
My pleasure.
Which I read with a lot of pleasure. Jonathan, let me start with the book, because I think that's where people will know you well from. Success in Africa, real big book. What year did it come out in?
At the end of 2013.
Yeah. So why don't you condense for our people what really was the, you know, I've read it, what were the themes in your opinion that people were missing the real story in Africa, that there was...
Yeah.
Why don't you describe it?
So... First, let me say that I'm not just being courteous when I say it's an honor to be with Ali Khan. I learn, you know, you get to know people remarkably, in a remarkably intimate way, even through social media.
It's frightening, isn't it?
You know, I feel like I know you very well.
Yes, vice versa.
Because I benefit from your insights sort of, you know, repeatedly. And yeah. So you're with me even when I'm not reading the feed or something. And then as for Success in Africa.
A mutual feeling. Oh, so thank you.
So, you know, I had been doing business in emerging markets for about 20 years when I wrote Success in Africa. Half in Asia, and then the second half, beginning about 10 years ago, here in Africa.
Yes.
And I found that doing work in Africa, I'd have the same experience every single time I came home. I'd go from here in Nairobi or from Lagos back to Europe. You know, it's a two-stage jump. At that time, there weren't direct flights, right? So you could jump into a plane into Europe and be on that plane from Africa, and everyone knew the story of Africa's growth, right? In fact, we were living that story on the plane. I'm not the only person who's done business on the plane.
Absolutely.
Right? And it just was a reality we were living. Everyone on that plane was living. Then I'd make the change, and I'd get on the plane back to my home in New York, and no one would know that story. Mm. You know, if I told them, I'm coming back from Africa, what were you doing? Of course they thought I was on safari, right? Because Africa's the land of happy animals and miserable people, right? But when I told them I was doing business, they either didn't believe me, usually thought I was in intelligence, or they would laugh.
Yes.
There was a lot of laughter around it. So, you know, that was this incredible asymmetry of information. Mm. So that's an interesting opportunity for not only to do good business, but it's an interesting opportunity for good storytelling.
Yes.
And at the same time, I was meeting executives here, African CEOs, who were not just great managers in Africa, they were some of the best managers I'd met anywhere in the world. Mm. And I've worked with, you know, Fortune 500 CEOs, some of whom are in Success in Africa. Mm. Jeff Immelt, the CEO of GE, Neville Isdell.
They've taken a huge position.
Absolutely. Yeah. Mm. Sure, I saw Jay Ireland, his Africa chief, many times, and then again just today. Mm. But, you know, Jeff will say the same thing, and Neville Isdell of Coke will say the same thing, that some of the best executives they've met in the world are right here in Africa, and dealing with a variety confronting a variety of issues that I'll talk about this in a second, but have become global issues, but which are tough, longest and toughest here. Mm. And so, you know, the opportunity to tell a story with great characters like that was just very compelling to me. I felt that was a great way to reintroduce my part of the world to this part of the world.
Oh, fantastic.
And so that was really the driver for Success in Africa.
You know, well, what I've noticed actually with the US in particular, and I didn't know whether it was the Obama visit to Kenya, but they clearly heard the signal that you picked up a little bit earlier. They came subsequent to that. So it's interesting to see that actually there was a cause and effect. You know, this information asymmetry seems to be ironed out a little bit, and we've seen US companies come looking for opportunities here. What do you think caused that?
So, I think that, listen, I think that there was a crest coming.
Yes.
Of which I was also riding, albeit an early rider, but I'm certainly not the first old China hand to make their way here.
Yes.
If you look at the executives that have led
the
charge.
That's an interesting point, yes.
Yep, if you look at the the founder of Emerging Capital Partners, yes. which is a private equity firm. If you look at the person who led Cummins for the first time yes. into Africa, now they have a big presence. If you look at GE, the current CEO of Africa, they all have had significant Asia experience mm. before coming here.
But then quite a few executives who've had that experience tell me, Ali Khan, it just didn't happen in the same way.
It didn't happen in the same way, right. And that's a mistake.
And what would you say, just sorry to carry on with this theme, is what was the difference, would you say? Because, I mean, I've got friends of mine who said, Ali Khan, you know, Asia was much more monolithic, it was bigger, whereas Africa was more diverse, pockets of demand that you're trying to knit together. What would you say?
So I'll tell you the biggest thing I think that's different and the biggest thing that I think is the same.
Yes.
And I think they're both important.
Yes.
So the biggest thing I think that is different is, particularly if you did a lot of business in China, is that Africa is 54 or 55 markets, yes. depending on who's counting. And the cultural distinctions are vast even within each country, right?
Yes, yes.
Now there's cultural distinctions within China as well, and provinces are distinct, but not nearly to the degree that you find in Africa. And so you have to be conscious of that and not treat Africa as an undifferentiated whole. I argue to people that Africa is, there is an Africa as a whole, there is a unity here that makes sense, but it's a differentiated whole, and if you miss either the whole or the differentiation, you miss a lot. So that's what's dissimilar, is how yes. how differentiated it is. What I found consistent, and what I think is a key to why Asian foreign investors do well here, is an ability to perceive opportunity through a short-term fog yes. of difficulties and challenges. They're able to look at a landscape, like you and I talked about Makuru just now.
Yes, yes.
They're able to look at that landscape and see opportunity.
Yes.
There are, that is a unique capability that I think, frankly, more American executives could learn.
That's interesting. So you think the volatility actually sort of hardens their ability to spot the opportunity?
Yeah, and not just geopolitical volatility.
Yes.
I would say more than volatility, it's lack. It's,
yes.
it's what is not here.
Yes.
So you can tell, I can tell in the first minute off a plane if I'm with a bunch of executives
yes.
or investors with me, how it's going to play out for them in Africa. Maybe that's a bit of grand, but
wow.
but I'll say explicitly, if a person, you know, they'll get off the plane and they'll say, holy cow, if I can use a nice phrase, holy cow, there is so much missing here.
Yes.
And if they then say, that's an opportunity.
Yes.
Then that's someone who can thrive in Africa.
That's amazing.
If they say instead, there's no way to make opportunity here,
yes.
that's really someone who should just get back on the plane.
Yeah, so really it's a mindset issue, you think, in a part.
I think it's a huge issue. That is the huge differentiator between those who have the opportunity to then go on and succeed here and those who really are just going to struggle.
Let me now take you back again to the book. You met all these interesting CEOs,
yeah.
people who've taken risk, entrepreneurs. Who stood out for you? I mean, you know, and yeah. what sort of lessons did you feel? You know, I know it's not easy, but
yeah. yeah. So it's like, you know, it's like asking me to choose amongst my children,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So
I wouldn't want you to do that.
I learned so much from all these men and women. So let me mention a couple and what
yes.
and what I thought was terrific about them. So first I'll begin here in your native land.
Yes.
So listen, I have many fine Kenyan friends, but you know, Vimal Shah is
yes.
someone who's become a very dear friend to me.
Yes.
And through the book, I met him.
Yes.
I met him at that time. And what he taught me on that issue of seeing nothing and creating opportunity
yes.
is tremendous. The that you need to what you, if you don't have what you if you don't if there's not if you don't see what you need, then build what you need.
Mm.
You know what he's built around his entire value chain, right? Because he needed to guarantee himself that
Bidco,
value chain.
Yes,
the Bidco CEO. That's right.
Yes,
that's right. And he came, you know, he and his father built a company focused on edible oils, right? The consumer product, but then backward integrated into the oils that go into the ingredients
yes.
that go into that oil, into the primary processing, and ultimately all the way back to the plantation.
Yeah.
You would never find someone to do that in the U.S.
Yes.
It's just not. It's not the existing paradigm.
Yes.
Right? I think another was. James Mwangi,
yes.
Right, at Equity Bank.
Bank.
That's
yes,
right.
Yes.
So the way in which James talks with sensitivity about his customer
yes.
and his understanding for that he says, for example, how they need to be close to their money because
yes.
their life is unplanned.
Yes.
All right. What a powerful insight.
Yes.
And one, frankly, that I would never get from Jamie Dimon, right?
Yes,
at JP Morgan
yes.
Chase. Very smart guy. Doesn't have that feel for yes. what's going on in the customer landscape, right?
That's very
so, you know, those insights are fantastic.
And if you look, you know, if you look back now, 2013, I remember I was at a, or 2014, I was at a conference, and there was this, the tide was floating all the boats,
yeah.
right? You know,
yeah.
there was a ton of liquidity yeah. washing around the system.
Yeah.
Zambia could put out a Eurobond and get 15 times oversubscribed.
Yeah.
And now if you look over the last 12 months, it's been a very different landscape.
Yeah.
What, how are you reading it? What do you think has changed? What is, what would you be saying now, yes. given, you know, what we're
yeah.
seeing?
Yeah. So first, I certainly don't want to be Pollyannish about the current environment.
Yes.
It's a challenging environment
yes.
for emerging markets generally, obviously for commodity producers
yes.
and those who count on them specifically. And I think that this is a challenging testing time for the continent as a whole.
Yeah.
Having said that, I think that there are more than just pockets of opportunity. Mm. I think there continue to be extraordinary wells of opportunity mm. within the continent. But it begins to differentiate. You know, it begins to differentiate those which were existing just on the high tide of commodities,
yes, yes.
and those which had more internal drivers. So I happen to, you know, I think that that greater East Africa, you know, the EAC,
yes.
let's say plus Ethiopia,
yes.
Is a place that is being driven by much more by internal drivers,
yes.
than external drivers. Things like better governance,
yes.
better education,
yes.
and obviously better connectivity,
yes.
not just mobile but now broadband mm. and all the forms of connectivity of the society, right? Mm. You know, whether it's something
so
like
you think
Jumia
this region
or whatever.
Is a bright spot.
Yeah, and it's not just me that thinks mm. that. You know, I recently saw a map that Bloomberg put out of the just around Christmas. They put out a map of where does opportunity lie in the world in 2016.
I saw
and they and there were two, you know, and it was just GDP mm. figures, you know, projections from the IMF put onto a graph with dark spots representing 6% growth or more. Well, there were two big clots of dark. Mm. One was Southeast Asia, South
yes.
and Southeast Asia, and the other was Greater East Africa.
Yes.
And they had, the funny thing was that then Bloomberg provided enormous anecdotal commentary about Southeast Asia and said nothing about Africa, as if they hadn't seen the spot. Well, that's, you know, that's sort of a Rorschach test of where you think the future's going.
No, and that's right. And that happens sometimes to
yeah.
Africa. Yes. So, okay, so you see this.
So
is
I do see, I'll call it Greater East Africa
yeah.
as a continuing hotspot, demonstrably so, right?
Yes.
It's not just me that thinks that. And you know, and I continue to feel it around Nairobi.
And when you look at, this Greater East Africa, you look at the rest of Africa. What pitfalls do you think people have got to avoid in these more difficult times? Do you think? I mean, you know, we're talking about some countries that rode very high.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, oil, copper,
right.
insatiable Chinese demand. You yeah. know, you just dug a well and money popped mm. out.
So I think I find it easier to think about the places where I think there's ongoing continued opportunity,
yes.
by not just place, but like sector or opportunity.
Yes.
Broadly speaking, I think that things which are, you know, my general proposition is that goods and services that will improve the productivity mm. of a wide swath of people, not
yes.
the very few, because
yes.
I think that's you know, the very few can change very quickly, but they improve the productivity of wide swaths of people. So I think that all kinds of software and technology that enables people to do their jobs better will continue to sell here. There'll just be continued uptake of those kinds of products. Anything that sheds light in the darkness. So data products. I'm invested
yes.
in two kinds of data
yeah.
companies.
Why don't you talk about that? Because we were talking about that.
Oh, we were talking about that before.
Yes,
right.
yes.
So anything that sheds that brings greater data
yes.
to an environment that is otherwise opportunity rich, like mm. East Africa, but which, so East Africa, for example, is data, is opportunity rich, but data poor.
Yes.
Right? There are in all of Reuters and Capital IQ and all the other
yes.
global reporters combined, there are about 200 East African companies reported on. Period.
Yes. yes.
Right?
Yeah.
There are easily 30,000. That's going to be conservative. 30,000 companies of
in the universe
of five, no 5 million or more 5 million
wow.
or more in turnover.
Wow.
So that's, you know, and that's of latest thinking, I think, from Abraj.
Yes.
You know, it's based off that. So nobody has the data on those companies. So I'm invested in a company called Asoko Insight, which has offices here in Kenya, as well as Nigeria and in South Africa, that does a very simple thing. They provide corporate data, quality corporate data on African corporates, those corporates that are missing, those 30,000, to a global audience via an online platform, right? And it's not 30,000 at the start. It's, you know, it's 1,500 today.
Yes.
It'll be 5,000 by the end of the year.
Yes.
But but that's already, you know, almost an order of magnitude more than is already out there.
Wow.
Right? So that's, you know, I have high confidence that bringing just a little more of that daylight data to a place where there's opportunities but not a lot of information is a great idea. Another one is FIO Corporation.
Yes.
Where I'm an investor and advisor. They address health data,
yes,
distinct from corporate data, and their aspiration is to support. They bring those two things together: improving the productivity of the health worker, and the quality of the work they do by providing them devices that help them guide them through their workflow,
yes,
while simultaneously capturing the data,
yes,
from the healthcare process. So instead of coming back to the clinic at the end of the day or week or month and transcribing the data by hand, which is mostly how it's done now. All the data is captured in the course of providing quality care.
Wow.
Right? So there you have the two coming together.
Is that a private solution that's being offered to people, or is that in the is that a public government type solution that you're looking to promote?
So FIO is a private for profit company, but it's offered to the public and is primarily and is been piloted in Meru County already with the public health services, but then also available through private hospitals and ultimately through insurers.
Wow. Okay. So you've become a bit of an entrepreneur from coming out of the consulting world, academia, and now really putting your own money to work. Is that because you've locked in on the opportunities?
You're like
a trader. You want to put your money down and see what
Maybe I'm a little late to it, right? Well, I certainly was inspired by some of the executives who most of the executives who in Success in Africa I knew in one way or another.
Yes.
But talking to them more deeply about their journey,
yes,
I said, you know what? There's a lot of lessons here coming out of the book. Why don't I put some of these to work and put my money where my mouth is?
Very good. So, Jonathan, what are you doing this time? You've been visiting Africa or just Nairobi?
I'm in Africa about 25% of my time. My family and I live in the States.
Yes.
And my children go to school there. My child goes to school there.
Yeah.
But you can't just not be here. You can't come in just once in a while and be in any way effective. Yeah. So for me, and indeed, you know, I think it's fair to say that I don't know any one country in Africa as well as, you know, any dozen people who are there, you know, any really good person who's there full time. But there is a value in knowing these countries well and knowing these countries at the level I do and having relationships in the States.
Yeah.
And, you know, that translation effect has an ongoing value even as the States gets to know Africa better.
Yes. And you can play a key position in that.
One hopes so.
Now, let me ask you a couple of questions about, you know, geopolitics of Africa.
Yeah.
How are you reading that today? I mean, you know, what observations would you make about that situation? And, you know, does it have an impact on Africa's economies? Yeah. Have you seen any trend changes? How do you read it?
So let me say that I would speak to your audience, which I view as a savvy and informed audience, much differently than I would speak if we were on, you know, global TV on the BBC or something, and speaking to a general audience who I think just read the headlines and always allow the headlines to play into their pre-existing narrative of Africa.
No, true.
You know, so and that happens tremendously. That continues to happen in Europe and the U.S. You know, the slightest event in anywhere in Africa reflects poorly on all of Africa. We certainly saw that in Ebola, you know, on the Ebola virus, right?
We did.
Where you had people, I knew people unwilling to shake the hands of Kenyans or anybody who came from Kenya
because
they thought they had Ebola.
Yes,
right.
Yes.
So, you know, and so that was unfortunate, and I think that, you know, as I say, it just reminded me to always understand that people have a very deeply ingrained narrative of Africa elsewhere. So, but I know that your audience is more savvy than that. So what I would say is, I think that democratic transitions, and I don't just mean that by elections, but really empowerment of a larger and larger group of people and voices, and giving them voice in the population through social media are inexorable trends that can, that I see continuing in Africa.
Yes.
Are there presidents running for third terms when the law says that they shouldn't, or moving to make the changes? Sure there are, and I'm not passing judgment on those for now. But that does go on, and democracy moves in uneven steps across the continent and in different places. But overall, the empowerment of people, whether through elections or through media, seems to me to continue to move in a very favorable way. I'll say what is a major concern and a drag on the economy is security, and particularly security in the face of extremist violence, right, of religious extremism. I think about what I worry about in Nigeria or even here in Kenya. Is not my personal safety. I feel safe in the places I'm in, but that an event will that an event or series of events will cause disruption, and I think that's why it's been so important, for example, and so very successful that the way in which Kenya has handled a series of high-profile global events.
Yes.
The visit of my president, certainly, the Global Entrepreneur Summit.
Which was a huge visit.
Right?
Yeah.
I thought that came off flawlessly.
Wow.
Not just, I was here.
Yes.
It went through flawlessly, not just in Nairobi, which everyone sort of expected, but throughout the country.
Yes.
That was very important, right? Because one would have thought that the enemies of the state, and really the enemies of peace,
would have taken
the opportunity, right?
In a way, I was surprised they didn't.
Yeah.
But well, that shows how
you know. I wouldn't be surprised if they did, but the opportunity was thwarted. You know, I'm prepared to put to see those events in that light, and I see it in that light because there's been subsequent events that have proved it out. Most recently, you know, we had President Buhari here this week.
Yes.
But there was just a ministerial meeting of the WTO.
Correct.
Right. Each one of these events puts the threat of insecurity more in the rearview mirror. Of course, it always looms. You're always, you know, Nairobi, the same as my home, New York, is always only one event away from bringing back people's fears.
Yeah.
So, but we all live with that globally.
Yes. And I think, I suppose what I found was, you know, 2-3 years ago, it felt we were living on our own, but now suddenly, you know, you've seen it.
Tell me about that. What do you mean you felt? I know I'm supposed to answer questions.
I think, you know, we had the attack at Westgate and it felt like, okay, it was over in Nigeria, but that, you know, Kenya was like a target, but now one feels you see it happen in Egypt.
Yeah.
You've seen it spread all over. Yeah. It's sort of there's been a diffusion of.
Let me tell you a story
about
Westgate and being alone.
Yeah.
So in the hours after Westgate, you know, the news went global, and in the hours after Westgate, I was in the States and got wind of this and immediately called. The woman in New York who had coordinated New York's response in the wake of 9/11, right? And is a hero to me and to many others. And I had to tell her what had happened, right? Because she hadn't seen it. She looked. She said, "Hold a minute." And she looked on her BlackBerry and saw the news about Westgate, and this was late in the evening on New York Time. And she said, "Give me 5 hours." Mm. Give me a few hours, and within half an hour, I was getting input from 10 different companies on their recovery plans in the wake of 9/11, and all of them said the same thing. They said, "We went through this; it was terrible. We're there. We want to do this with the people of Nairobi." And ultimately, we did a series of such transfers of knowledge, and ultimately, we did a teleconference between some of the leadership of KEPSA and some of the leadership of New York's companies at that time to share that information and also share a sense of sentiment of belonging. I'll never forget that. The host of that meeting, Dan Doktoroff, who was at that time the president of Bloomberg, and had been before the deputy mayor of New York during our crisis, he said, "You know, we got help from London when we had our crisis, and we want to be there for Nairobi during this moment." So even in that moment,
fantastic, you know, well done for doing that, because I think, you know, during Westgate we felt the response wasn't, you know, there was a lack of clarity as to how the government was responding at the time, and I think people felt quite insecure at that time.
Yeah, I could sense that.
Which I'm sure it was the same feeling in New York.
There was a tremendous sense of insecurity at that time, and I remember at that time the most particular sense of insecurity was at a very personal level. People were staying in their houses.
That's right.
People were not going out.
Yeah.
And when the people started, when people started returning to the streets, and one, you know, Dan talked about this. He said one of the most important things they did at that time. He laughed because he hadn't reflected on it in 10 years. So one of the most important things that happened at that time was we held, about a week after the event, held a concert in Times Square.
Yes.
And tens of thousands of people turned out for it. And it just signaled that it was okay to be outside, to be with your neighbors, to be with one another and enjoying your city.
Going back to, you were talking about risks on the continent, the insecurity, do you see any other risks of that magnitude?
To the economies.
Yeah.
To be honest, so you know the seemingly prolonged series of near crises in the global economy obviously is having an effect on the economies of Africa as well.
Yeah.
But I don't view those as acute threats. Those are it's a prolonged sort of new normal that we're finding our way in, and I have a lot of confidence in some of the executives I just described to find their balance in that new normal.
Yes.
Otherwise, I wouldn't be investing as I am
course.
Africa, right? To me, the acute threat of those kind of security issues is is really a thing unto itself, separate from all the other risks I see in the economy, in the economies at least that I'm active in, the economies in this area.
And going to the big beasts like China, obviously China, Africa, it's such a big story. Chinese slowdown.
Yeah.
We've seen the U.S. come back into Africa in a big way.
Yeah.
Led by the corporate sector, US AFRICOM is here already. Mm-hmm. How do you see that sort of dynamic playing out now?
China and the US.
China, US, India, Japan, in their relationships with Africa, do you think somebody's got the lead, somebody hasn't? What's your feeling about all of that?
Yeah, so I actually, my experience of this is that, there's a lot of talk about China's influence in Africa, in the States. I think we talk about it a lot more than Chinese or Africans do sometimes.
Yes.
And there's a lot of gnashing of teeth about it. My experience has been that, while there's difficulties in every relationship, the Chinese and more broadly the Asian investment in Africa has had a very favorable effect.
Mm.
Again, there's different relationships with different companies,
but
overall the net effect is very favorable, and I don't think a lot of the African infrastructure could have been built without it.
Yeah.
Right. So, and in fact, if that actually is a concern to me, because there's a lot of infrastructure yet to be built.
Yes.
And the financing of it out of China is bound to slow.
Yes.
It's bound to slow, and so we need to see other places of it happening. But ultimately, there's only one place that infrastructure should be developed from, and that's internally, from internal resources.
Mm.
So if it catalyzes African pension funds and other African asset holders to invest more in Africa, that should be happening anyway.
Let
that's
me just
more
go,
favorable.
Back to that point about domestic mobilization. Yeah. I mean, a lot of African countries went to the Eurobond market, borrowed in hard currency.
Yeah.
Is that why you made that comment?
Yeah,
you think that's a risk.
Yeah, I think that's already
playing out.
Yeah, it's worrisome. I certainly understand the decision by policymakers to go out and find that money, but ultimately that is not sustainable for exactly the reasons we're seeing now, right? I mean, the currency risk is very enormous.
Yes.
And while it works well in a downtime, these are long-term obligations, right? So I do think that is why I think that. So, but going back to your question about the dynamics amongst these players, certainly I think you'll see some shift. I think, if I can express some confidence in my countrymen, I think that we are seeing that America is coming to recognize the value more and more. Each time I go to a conference, I see more American large companies understanding
it. It's amazing, actually. There's a real trend change.
There's a real change. And there's in the corporate sector and beginning in the financial sector.
Mm.
Oddly, the financial sector lagged behind the corporate sector in finding the opportunity here. Now I think they're catching up, and you see our largest private equity funds are each putting in assets here. They're hiring very smart people, very capable people, to find the assets. I think they're generally doing it in a smart way, and that they are having people based on the continent and talent that is from the continent do a lot of the leadership there. That's of course the right way to do it. And with that comes a greater engagement. And then I think American geostrategic engagement has a long way to go, but I think AFRICOM has come a long way already.
Yes.
And that, especially given what I said about the biggest threat being security,
yes.
the intersection, you know, if we can walk in lock, if we can walk on two legs of shared security and shared commerce,
yes.
I think that's that can be proving that can prove to be a very strong.
You think that's the two step?
Yeah. I would never want to see the security misused, right? Which is a risk when you do when you have relationships like that. But I think that so far this is a very useful dynamic.
Do you see Japan, India, and these other players playing a bigger role?
Yeah, some bigger and some smaller. So I see India. It does seem to me is doing quite well and is catching up. I think to both China and the States in terms of their engagement here. It seems to me that Airtel, for example, has really found its feet and is doing and is succeeding in places where I didn't used to see it succeed.
Yes.
That's just a very visible example. But others, others. Whether they are Indian companies or, you know, whether they may be based in Dubai, but really, you know, with Indian guidance, right? And I see a lot of that are doing quite well. That's another major player that I hear. I find remarkable how little I hear about their interaction in Africa and their impact. And that's the Gulf.
Yes.
I find, like, for example, the Emirati companies, the UAE companies, remarkably focused and savvy about the African market.
Yes.
I find it a pleasure to work with them.
And do you think they are going to grow in their
I know they are.
They are.
Yeah. So I recently did an exercise in which I talked to 12 of the largest companies based in the UAE and asked them where are you looking for growth. Africa was number one or number two in every one of those conversations.
Wow, that's good to hear.
Yeah, absolutely.
So looking forward, with all your experience, how do you feel about the next 2-3 years? What do you think it's going to look like? You've already told us where you think the opportunities are, but if you can just wrap it up for us.
Yeah. So I think, you know, I think that we've come through a very hard time. Commodities are going to continue to be a struggle.
You don't see a V-shaped rally or anything like that, which is...
So there are, you know, there are those whose crystal balls are clearer than mine on this, but I ask them, right? And from what I hear, I think there's probably a U, right? And we're not at the end of the bottom of the U, right? There's another, there's more time to go through that, to get through that tranche before we're back. And so for commodity dependent countries, there's going to continue to be a restructuring that's needed. I'm optimistic, though, about what some of the things I see around that in terms of governance improvement.
Yes.
So in Nigeria, right? Nigeria is going through a challenging time, to
Very
be sure, right?
Yeah.
But I see tremendous improvements in aspects of governance already. Mm. Already, so early in the Buhari administration, they obviously had a slow start getting their cabinet in place.
Yes.
But I see improvements in governance of the oil sector, in how various other aspects of governance are run without the benefit of all that of all this income that doesn't come from taxation, right? So I think we'll see improvements in the tax in how taxes are managed, because you have to now find money from another source.
I think they've got the lowest,
right?
Yeah, tax to GDP type.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. So I think that those that I to me, I see those benefits as very significantly improving Nigeria's long-term potential. That's easy to say for me because I you know, it's tough for someone living, you know, in the outskirts of Lagos, who's living day to day. But over the long term, this strikes me as not a bad thing, and I continue to run investments to Lagos.
To Lagos, but think Nigeria is like an outlier, or you know, will these commodity countries use this moment to make those key reforms, or do you think it could be a lot messier?
Yeah.
Because you've also got this competing thing that, you know, commodity countries, there was a sort of compact where some money flowed down, you kind of bought off the opposition.
Yes.
And now you haven't got that much money to distribute.
Sure.
You've got a much more alert population who are all on social media going, what the heck's happening?
Yeah. Yeah. So I think the risk of everything you just described is that there's short-term political disruption.
Yes.
Right? And you know, I, knock on wood, it will not be violent, but there's that possibility. I can't say that's not going to happen, right? But what I would say is that, you know, I said earlier that the those who succeed can look through the fog of short-term lack of basic needs for investment. The same is true around these kinds of issues. These kinds of short-term volatility is another point of distinction between those who succeed here yeah. and those who don't. That if you can look through short-term uncertainty,
yes.
and this is if I'd say one thing of the 30-odd executives
yes.
who are in success in Africa, every one of them share this characteristic of being able to grasp the difference between short-term uncertainty and long-term opportunity.
That's a great way to put it.
Yeah, and I think that challenge is very acute right now.
Jonathan, pleasure speaking to you today.
And you.
Thank you for making time.
All right, be well.
Thank you.